session. As usual, the first session will be in general. We are talking with the batsman. The batsman is today. You know about his Dhoni's tail. He will play well, and he knows the situation how to play. And definitely, he will even before he comes into stage and the applause what he gets that shows. And the topic also which he is going to talk is also very relevant for the today's entire session. Various issues are there in construction industry, and the work contractor, what are the issues they are facing, and the contractor who is in realty sector, as well as developers, and work contractors, service tax, GD builders case, five member case, any cases relating to constitutional aspects, you can see Venkatraman there. That is specialty of Venkatraman, and he is whenever any programs on chamber on taxation, and the first person to accept and who comes always is Mr. N. Venkatraman, and there is no need for introduction, but for the sake of this one, I introduce Mr. Venkatraman to the audience. Mr. N. Venkatraman worked under the guidance of C. Natarajan, senior advocate, from 89 to 2003. He was designated as senior in February 2006 at the very young age, 40 years itself he got senior, and he has appeared so far around 20 high courts across the, you can see all the sales tax cases or any taxation cases in all the courts. You can see Venkatraman has appeared for all the courts. And now he is presently practicing in Delhi, appearing before Supreme Court, besides other matters like tribunals, settlement commission, authority for advance ruling, settle appellate mechanism, and what not. And he is a fully busy man. He renders advice and assistance on transfer pricing issues, international taxation, matter relating to GAR, SAR, at a global level. He has been part of various special committees rendering assistance to rule on important transfer pricing on taxation issues. He has shifted to New Delhi in October 2011, and he is appearing before the Honorable Supreme Court, Delhi High Court, and other forums. So this is a brief about Venkatraman, and we can talk more about Venkatraman, and but we may have to hear from Venkatraman. Over to. Thank you, sir.
The love I share with Madras Chamber, because first it's with my old friends and very reliable friends. I'm so happy to speak one more time, and any number of times it's worth it to talk to Chamber. Any successful lawyer, we will deem ourselves to be successful on taxation side, evolving as from South India, especially from Tamil Nadu, he could not have evolved without his participation in Madras Chamber. I think all of us, you have all evolved us, so we should always be very indebted. I say this with my heart in it. Fine. See, let me put it in 2-3 pockets, what I wish to speak. I thought I will speak first on the larger bench in disaster. That's something which you should know, how a clean point, something which constitutional bench has said several decades before what the law is, can be ignored today by a tribunal. This is where we are actually heading towards. What is law today? Law is what one feels about law, and not what law is. That's exactly where we are placed. And this judgment is a clear indicator in that direction. Let me tell you how. Commercially, we have three dispensations. Somebody sells this pen, I sell it to PRSL. we call it in commerce as a pure sale because it is chattel to chattel. I advised each one of you on a particular legal matter. Then we call it as a rendition of a pure professional service. No confusion. One is a sale because it deals with goods. Another is a service because it does not deal with goods. Now you have a combination of both. Take this building. You can't sell this building like a pen, nor offer it like a lawyer service. It requires cement, steel, bricks, etc., etc., plus an element of human labor. So when both get together, you form a new animal in commerce called a works contract. So all the three are not the same. And therefore, in 55 Madras High Court, which was confirmed in 58 Supreme Court, first constitutional bench said, this new animal called works contract is a special species. You cannot put it under the gambit called sale. Don't treat works contract as sale, even though it involves goods in it. That was the law. It took 2.5 decades because by the time when the economy started growing, we see law and transactional models is a chase, always, all over the world. We are now talking of BEPS, we are talking of POEM, all these law. What is BEPS? Basic erosion of profit ratio. Why does it emerge? Globally, we found out leading MNCs pay 2 to 3% income tax of their global income. So they found out transfer pricing law is ineffective. So you should go, it's not enough if you touch it on the value. You should go deeper. Therefore, go and see the erosion base. And now the model papers are emerging every day. OECD is pushing papers on this. POEM is like that. Place of effective man. India section 6 says earlier, wholly and exclusively. Now, the present amendment in this budget, they have taken that, removed that expression. So, when you see a transaction and you see a failure to capture that into tax, then you chase the law. This is the usual practice. So, works contract law is no such exception. So, the 46th amendment was enacted to say, we will capture this special animal also to tax. Because Supreme Court has said it is not either sale or service, it's a separate species, we will tax the separate species. And that's why this 46th amendment. No confusion. Post the 46th amendment, two issues came up before the constitutional benches and various high court. One was, okay, you have now given a power under the constitution, empowering the states. You did not have service tax at that point of time because service tax came only in 1994. So in a building where there is a service portion and in a sale portion, the states are empowered to tax the sale portion, was the definition of works contract at that point of time. Rest was left to service. There was a need, just a sentence on constitution to understand the basic platform. Whether you needed a constitutional amendment when you bring a service tax on works contract, you don't need a constitutional amendment. The reason is, you have entry 97, which is the residuary entry in list 1. Parliament has got a special right to tax. When something is not taxable by the state, Parliament can tax it under entry 97. So you don't need a constitutional amendment to tax something. You have the power traceable to entry 97. You can just legislate. But that's not the case with sale. So entry 54, which only empowered state to tax sale, they couldn't tax works contract, and therefore they brought the 46th amendment. After bringing the 46th amendment, two basic disputes arose. In Andhra Pradesh, Hotel Dwaraka, the Advocate General argued, we now have the 46th Amendment. What is the problem? We can now tax under the Act. We don't have to amend and create a charging section for works contract in sales tax law. Because Constitution gives us the right to tax. rejected by the division bench. It said, Constitution only empowers you to tax, but you must exercise that power by creating a charge. Already, constitutional bench has said sale is different from works contract, so the definition of sale is not adequate to tax works contract. So you must have a separate charging section for works contract. That's how Andhra Pradesh High Court put it. Three other high courts, Patna, Orissa, and Chennai, Madras, said, as charge is very important, so Ramakrishna was reading Govind Charan, Ganga Charan, that's our Vedic formula for tax, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, charge, person, entity, and measure. So, what it said, these three high courts, it's not enough if you create merely a charge, you must create a proper machinery to tax it. You should clearly identify which component is taxable by the state. Measure is very, very, very important. And why did they say? That's important. Why did they say? See, as practitioners of taxes or involved in taxation side, that's one basic. Measure is something which can be expansive. As long as charge holds the measure, is one doctrine. So, can there be some sort of a flexibility in measure? Instead of 20 rupees, can you tax 30 rupees? It's not an offense. It's not an offense. But this business, what the high courts discussed, which is upheld by the Supreme Court, is not 20 or 30. What high court said was, we utter a caution that there must be a clear dissection of the measure, because what are the two components? One is a sale component, another is a service component. If you don't dissect correctly, if states are going to charge value on service, and if Union of India is going to tax value on sale, it's not a question of measure there. You are encroaching into the constitutional power of yet another participating partner in the federal structure. Taxing value of service is unconstitutional. It's not something to do with measure. So they said, you have no business, you have to define. This was the matter which went from Rajasthan to the constitutional bench, second Ganandakal. Why should otherwise 5 judges of the Supreme Court spend weeks together and keep writing, because there was no legislation at that point of time, labor, electricity, consumable, site expenses, you see the judgment. Each ingredient was identified as what is liable for tax under the works contract for sale and how to leave the residual balance to the union. So it's a question of measure. So three things are very clear now. You need to define works contract under the constitution for the state to tax. You don't have to do that for union. That's number one. Two, it's not enough if you just define works contract. It's not enough. You have to create a charge in your legislation and you have to create a measure in your legislation. So every sales tax enactment, if you see, there is a definition of works contract. And every sales tax and VAT enactment, you see, there is a machinery provision saying what is deductible or not. This is the simple, elementary, primary school lesson on works contract. I think it's so clear. Can there be any confusion? Now, what did we say before 5 judges? We only said the roadmap is already laid. Why don't you follow the roadmap? What is the roadmap? If you come to the finance tax, service tax legislation, you have an entry called commercial and industrial construction, erection and installation, residential, etc., etc. And on 1/6/2007, you specifically bring works contract service. So we asked 2 questions to the court. If you feel that works contract can be taxed on commercial construction or residential construction, why did you bring it on 1/6/2000? What was the necessity to bring it? The necessity to bring it because first constitutional bench said this is a separate animal. Works contract is neither sale nor service. It's a mixture. So it's a third category of commercial transaction. So we said, all your definition of erection and installation and commercial construction is dealing with pure rendition of labor. This building, you can do it as a pure labor. If this hotel is going to supply the cement, steel, etc., etc., you apply only your sweat, the building will still emerge, without a doubt. So those transactions will come under that definition, pure labor definition. Whereas if I supply material and also put the sweat and construct this hotel, then it is liable to works contract tax. So this was the first point. So you did not have a charge. The second, you did not have a measure. When you brought works contract tax on 1/6/2007, you also brought a valuation rules 2 capital A, amended it, and said whatever has been conceived by the constitutional bench in Gannon and Curley as sale of goods, you excluded that and said the balance will be taxed as labor. Do you have a proper machinery provision prior to 1/6/2007? No. Then we said, now you, when you say that you don't have the definition, you don't have the machinery. Now please apply the history of 60 years. You don't have to create anything. There's no big versatility or imaginative or an out of the box exercise in this. You have to simply apply the law, which is 60 years old. Unfortunately, three technical members and two judiciary, it's a clear divide between judiciary and the non-judiciary. The disaster which the constitutional bench highlighted in the second NTT judgment, tribunalization of justice, it's a classic example. It's the Keshavananda Bharati case of the CSTAT, I should say. When Keshavananda Bharati started 13 judges, day one, it was a split between 7-6. You must read the book written by whoever is a law student or interested in law. You should read the book Mr. Anjarjuna, former Solicitor General, who has written about Keshavananda Bharati. It's 150 pages. There is one strong feeling that it has some fiction. It never mind, you just read it. From day one, Supreme Court was split into 7-6. From day one, when they heard the matter for 5 days, it was 3-2. And what is the law today? Three technical members together write, the charging provision of pure service is good enough to include works contract. That's the law today. Please understand, law of the country at the tribunal. Somebody dares to go against the constitutional bench judgment. Constitutional bench said this is a separate animal. Don't call it and put it with sale. When you can't put it with sale, you can't put it with pure service. As simple as that. Second mistake, second disaster, it says, this is nothing but every works contract is a contract for service. Finished. So, lawyer rendering a professional advice and a builder building this hotel, both are only contract of service according to these three learned members. See, I'm more anxious. Do not think that we lost a case. Winning and losing for a lawyer is a daily job. So it doesn't matter at all. What is paining is a tribunal, which is an inferior body, is ready to take up and fight and write a judgment contrary to constitutional bench judgments of the Supreme Court. It's ready to do it. It's prepared. See the preparedness. I'm shocked there. And what are we going to leave it to our children? If this is the disaster step. So they say it is a contract of service and the pure definition of service is good enough. Good enough. Third mistake. You don't need a separate machinery. What is this? Service tax can only be on service. So every officer in the country will use his apply his mind and say this is liable to service, this is liable. Each one can do. This was what five judges of the Supreme Court in Damodar Swami Nadu said you should not do. Never give the discretion to an assessing officer as to what should be the measure of taxation. They will invent 500 different methodologies. And 500 methodologies will hit the Supreme Court. We will have no time to decide which is the right methodology. Methodology should always be with the framers, never with judiciary and never with quasi-judicial officers. Five judges have said this. Shown to them. They say, no, no, every officer in the country is brilliant enough. What is the confusion here? We have no problem. Why are they apprehensive? They will all do a nice job, like parent teachers meeting, rather than fighting a judicial case. What more do you need? What more? Okay. So they make these three crucial mistakes. Charge for pure service is good enough for charge for works contract. First theory. This is the law today. You don't need a machinery provision for works contract. The second law. And most disaster, works contract is a pure contractor service. And the president, who is a retired high court judge, spends 180 pages to write a dissent to say all this is rubbish. But he is still a minority. You must remember that. There are some, as a student of law, you should be happy. Sometimes dissenting judgments deliver better sense. There's a history of dissenting judgments. When H.K. Khanna wrote the dissenting judgment in Bengal, in Bhagalpur branding case, because of which he lost the race for chief justiceship in India, he said to his sister before delivering the judgment, I'm going to write this dissent and therefore I'm going to lose this. Let us meet together. I'm no longer likely to be the Chief Justice of India. He writes it to her sister and then signs the judgment. He lost the job. But Supreme Court Association rewarded him. Even in Court 2 today, in Supreme Court Court 2, his portrait is put there. And in less than half an hour, 50,000 rupees was collected for his portrait. And the association has to say, stop. We have enough money to put his portrait. This is the honor they gave to him for writing a dissent judgment boldly. But it has a history to it. So this judgment is a classic judgment which will join that history of historical precedence of dissent judgments. And what is bothering me is the technical members write in the judgment. What do they write? What is the use of listening, sitting in this larger bench and hearing this matter? I'm saying this is not in the judgment. Nothing is exaggerated. Why? Because there is a Delhi High Court judgment which says works contract are taxable prior to 1/6/2007. The High Court judgment is there, tribunal is bound by it. I do not know why we are wasting our time. We have argued for 2.5 days of the 5 days to say that Delhi High Court judgment is per incluriam. See, there is a doctrinal principle in law. A judgment of an appellate court binds a lower court. Nobody can dispute it. But there is an exception to that. Every law has an exception. Every golden rule has an exception. A golden exception. What is that exception? If a judgment is declared per incurium, whether an inferior court can declare an appellate court judgment as per incurium? Yes, it can. A superintendent of central excise today can pass a judgment and say that this high court is not, because it is per incurium for his own reasons. What is per incurium? Matters not brought to the court's notice. Matter not discussed by the court. Law laid down by a court overlooking existing judicial precedence of an appellate court. You have two constitutional bench judgments which was not cited in GD Builder. The historical concept of works contract, 61st Law Commission, not cited. So we catalog 10 to 12 items to say, in fact, the judge who wrote the judgment is a classic judge. But we said, this is a classic example of per incurium. Per incurium can happen in two ways. It can be because of the mistake of the court. That's one way of declaring something as per incurium. Another way is mistake of the counsel in assisting the court. You don't argue, you can't blame a court for that. So we showed this is a classic case where lack of assistance to a court, incoherent structuring of the case has resulted in this bad judgment. We have nothing to condemn about the court. We respect the court. But court has not been assisted to render a proper judgment. So declare it per incurium. And they declare it per incurium, minority, the judicial member, the president of the tribunal says it is peremptory. We cited English judgments, we cited Indian Supreme Court, several, starting from that famous Bristol aeroplane case. All history of House of Lords, everything was cited. What is peremptory? Now, whereas the team of three members say, once there is High Court, we should close our eyes, shut our ears, shut our mouth, and we should follow the judgment. That's not the law. So what, if you say High Court I will follow, you have an equal duty to follow your two constitutional bench judgments. Why are you not following that? If you want to follow High Court, what's your problem in not following constitutional bench? That was the only question I asked. He said, no, this is in favor of revenue, therefore we will follow. Suppose it is not in favor of, then it will be peremptorium. See, judgments which go in favor of revenue, no peremptorium, no incurium. Incurably good. But if it goes in favor of assessee, you can put them all. This is how now judgments are emerging. The trend-setting judgments are emerging. So, this is the brief, because I was told that I should stop at 11:20 and then take up 10 minutes of questions if there are any questions to it. Anyhow, now I want to highlight a few things on this judgment. Now you have understood what is this disaster all about. But this it culminated into a disaster according to me, more than the judgment. See, if it is a wrong judgment, at some stage we can cure it. So that there is an appellate mechanism. So I'm not worried about that. What I'm worried about that is the majority rights. You must find the time to read a few pages of this judgment at least. The judge who has written it with absolute eloquence. His language, his style, he is a very, very learned judge of a high court. In fact, he had plans to retire and he has purchased close to 1,500 books for him to just sit and read and spend his life. But there was a call to take up this position, so he took up this position. And just before he retired, he delivered one of the classic judgments on international taxation, this famous Sanofi case. So he has put it so eloquently. The majority comments. We may not have the legal verbose on the language of our learned president. You mock at your own member while writing a judgment. You criticize him. You criticize a view you are entitled to. See, we go to the media, write an article on a judgment. We are entitled to criticize a judgment. That's okay. But you can't criticize an individual who wrote it. Can you say that he wrote it in completely lost mind? You can't say. You say he lost this point, he's okay. You attack the judgment, not the judge. The larger bench attacks the judge. Two, it says, we have followed this Delhi High Court 3-4 times by the tribunal. Therefore, now we can't perform a judicial somersault. It will touch upon the institutional integrity. What does it mean here? Two judges have written a dissent judgment. Are you saying, are you questioning their integrity in the process? It will touch upon the judicial institutional integrity. You wrongly follow a High Court judgment 100 times. 101st time, are you entitled to argue peremptorium or not? Somebody keeps following 50 years. This was what happened in the Coalfield case. They are, when peremptorium was argued, they said, no, for 50 years we have followed. Supreme Court says, what if? If you want a concession saying that we don't want to disturb because it is 50 years old, both of you agree we'll concede it. Then we don't write a law there. If you want me to declare a law, if it is peremptorium, it can be declared peremptorium even after 500 years. After 500 judgments following that, because it's a principle that matters for law. See, we should stay, institutional integrity is what? It should always stay with truth and deliver truth. It should be ready to face hard realities and deliver truth. That is institutional integrity, not following a wrong pattern of judgment for years and say that we are preserving the integrity of the institution. So this is the second mistake this judgment makes. The third mistake, it says, we don't find anything even in common sense to sit and hear this matter when there is a high court judgment. This is the expression used to the judgment. It defies common sense to sit and hear when there is a high court. So my question is, then why did you sit? You could have recused. There are 30 members or 20 members. There are, it's not the tribunal has only 5 members. If you are so prejudiced, and if you are so personally feel that this judgment should not be touched, then don't sit. Don't, see, you should face the law. These are all body language techniques. Show the judgment, say it is wrong, ready to accept. See, please understand, as a professional, you can't be emotional. If you have to lose a case on law, you should lose and take it. But you can't lose it this way. It's not somebody winning or losing. Where are you taking judiciary to? In what path are you taking judiciary to? So, when Supreme Court says a superintendent cannot issue a predetermined show cause notice, Siemens judgment is a landmark judgment. If you issue a show cause notice with a preconceived view, then that officer is disabled to hear that matter, is what Supreme Court says. A judge, a tribunal member says, what is the earthly use of listening to you all fellows here for 5 days? Because that's the High Court, I already decided. Then why did you sit and write the judgment? This is the fourth point. And on measure, it says, we don't find any practical difficulty in implementation. Therefore, question that there is no measure is simply an allegation and an argument bought in on perversity. When constitutional bench says, 5 judges of the Supreme Court, please remember, my dear friends, when you did not have a proper measure under the sales tax legislation, 5 judges spent week after week, almost 4 weeks or 6 weeks, preparation went on for 6 weeks? 6 weeks. They said labor should be excluded. They sat and wrote. You see that it's all there in the judgment. So when you don't have a scheme, Supreme Court frames a scheme, what should form part of value and what should not form part of value. The members say it is bordering on an argument of this nature, borders on perversity. Whom are they questioning? Not the counsel who argued, not the client who is being represented. They're questioning what's, questioning whom is my doubt. Fine. So we can go on. I just gave you a glimpse of this. I call this a judicial disaster. I have the age now, and if you call it temerity, yes, to say this, because now it's the time for me to think of institutional crisis rather than winning or losing cases. This is a bad judgment which goes into the record of tax history. And I say this with utter contempt. Okay. Now we'll see this now on co-derivatives. 2-3 small bits, and then we'll take up questions. See, we were talking during the tea break. Why should it be a 4:1? That's the preference of a judge. One judge felt it is a sale. The rest of the judges felt it's a works contract. It's a matter of perception. There you don't create all this saying this is defying common sense, bordering on, you don't see all that there. A judge has his own views to say why it is a sin. Now, the very simple logic. In fact, we cited para 67 of Coney Elevators before this larger bench and said, this is exactly what, see how a constitutional court deals with the matter and how 3 technical members deal with the matter. It was argued by Punjab and Haryana State Advocate General before the Supreme Court in Coney Elevators. He said the same thing. Why are we bothered about all this works contract and all? What are we taxing? We are taxing goods. We will go to the definition of sale. Take the works contract. Start deducting all non-goods value. Arrive it at the value of sale and tax it as a sale. Please call erection of lifts as a sale. We'll give the necessary, all public interest litigation type of concession. We are dealing with statute. This was the suggestion made before the constitutional bench. And Justice Deepak Mishra condemns it. He says, any attempt to do this is defying the time spent in amending the constitution through the 46th constitutional amendment. this suggestion will result in a constitutional subterfuge. See the expression used by, they say it will be a fraud on the constitution if you want me to sustain this point. See how five judges of the Supreme Court react to this. Same situation. The situation is not different. You are saying, please call erection of lift as a sale. Whatever needs to be deducted, we will. Don't call it works contract. Please call it a sale. Five judges say, why have we invented this new animal called works contract in the constitution? If you want that to be called a sale, why at all we call it? So any attempt in that direction will be a judicial perversity under constitutional subterfuge, para 67, the judgment. Whereas here, three members say, no, we will declare the law, you don't need a separate provision, every officer is good enough, he has great sense of equivalence, he will apply the law and correctly tax only the service portion and not the service. So we'll call it, we will call works contract as pure contract of service, which five judges of the Supreme Court hesitated to say. So in Coney Elevators, one important progress which we have made, there was a confusion whether post BSNL judgment, whether dominant theory has surfaced again into the works contract. That was the confusion which Coney Elevator, without an ambiguity of doubt, settled it. It said, you must understand what BSNL said and what Coney Elevator said. Then there was no confusion at all. BSNL said, in a works contract, there is no dominant intention. Then why are you having works contract? If you are going to apply dominant intention theory post works contract scenario, then the whole concept of works contract will go for a toss. They only said, there are some contracts which are essentially service contracts by nature. One example is, a doctor, a surgeon administering a heart stent during a surgery. Because stent is nothing but goods. When the hospital buys it from the medical store, they buy VAT, they pay VAT and buy that stent. It's goods. But the surgeon who employs it at the time of the surgery to the patient, is he a dealer performing works contract of sale of stent plus service? See, judicially you must understand, but please understand, I'll give you another company. It may be hard to digest, but the comparable is this. You go and give your car in the garage for service, yeah? He changes parts. And he puts his labor and delivers you a repaired car, a serviced car, works contract only. So people does it is work contract. So when a garage delivers a serviced car, changing parts and putting this as service, why not you call a doctor, a surgeon, as a dealer in VAT, servicing a human body by putting stent and also putting a sweat? How is it different? Supreme Court says, let us be very human. We can't compare a non-human transaction with a human transaction. This is nothing but a performance of skill. It is essentially because, Supreme Court will always have a concept to distinguish. You can't say, I like this is not to be VAT. You can't say, a judge can't say. So the distinction they bring is, in a garage, the fellow identifies the price of the components separately and the price of his labor. It is discernible. In commerce, it is discernible. Whereas in a heart stent, today of course, if you want, you can choose a platinum stent or a gold tip or a pure iron. All the variations are there. But at a normal level, normative, simple human level, a patient is more concerned about his life, rather than choosing which sort of a stent he should wear. When it comes to glasses, it may be okay, but for heart stent, it's more a matter of affordability than a matter of aesthetics to it. So the judgment says, in such types of situation, there are no discernible prices for sale of goods and sale of service. Essentially, it is skill. You go to a doctor, a surgeon, not because he can sell you a beautiful stent. You go to him because he will treat you properly. So, therefore, they are actually service. And when there is no discernible component of transfer of goods, apply the dominant theory, call it as a service, and deem the whole thing as a contract of service. That's the only contract of service. In a service contract is an exception to works contract. Our members have said, no, the law today is works contract and contract of service are one and the same. So this is the departure. So this is it. Now this was all, now they said, everybody reinvented dominant intention before Boney Elevator and said, now dominant intention is to sell a lift and not therefore. Court said, post 46th amendment, no dominant intention. You have to be very non-emotional and dissect the goods value and the service value, tax the goods under the Sale of Goods Act, under the VAT Act, under the So, any questions? Or I will speak 5 more minutes and then wind up on GST. Any questions that I need to take, I think. Because there is a strong view today in the morning to discourage GST. See, but one point is, he also agreed. When ideas have to arrive, ideas must arrive. Now we are left with no idea has arrived. Okay, now we can't take it back. But there are concerns. See, that's what state governments are now talking with. See, why there is a delay? State government do not want formulas to be left to the discretion of the union or left to the discretion of rulemaking authorities. They say, if possible, bring the formula in the constitution itself, which we should not be. We should not be tinkering constitution like our income tax act. We should not do all that. So that may not happen. But they say, there must be a clear commitment on the formula on day one, so that successive governments do not interfere with it. So, see, it's like this. You are left with no option. We are a federal structure. We can't change the structure for the purpose of GST. We have two taxing bodies to tax a transaction. You can't have a unified GST. It's not possible. We must have only two types of GST. Only thing is, see, when we integrated, take bought back, it was originally for raw materials. Then it went to capital goods. Then it went to service. Are we benefited or not? We are benefited. Similarly, if you integrate union and state, and then it's a question of, see, the problem today is the assessee is sandwiched between the union and state. In a GST regime, there will be no bread or jam between the two breads. The two participating partners will fight with each other. That's a possibility, using you as a tool. I don't deny that. So here the design has to be, when the structure is in place, you have learned your problems, you know where the problems are. If you structure it at the first instant to an extent workable, we have to move into that. We have to see, we must, as we have integrated union levies together, it's time for us to integrate also the state levy. Giving the power of taxation still with the state, you can't take that power. How can you go for a unified GST? Then it's a constitutional amendment. Which state today will say, I don't have the power? Which state is ready to surrender its power to tax? No state. Everybody wants more power. In fact, when service tax came, the first three taxes, which still affect 75% revenue, telephone, share, and stock. Now, the states are now, in the original GST papers, if you read, states said, why don't you give two or three of the three to us? Rest you can have it, whatever formula you want. We will manage with these businesses what state is demanding. So all this confusion, my take on GST ultimately is, if the ruling government fails in Bihar election, it won't come, sir. It's as simple as that. It's so politically connected. It's a political doctrine, not a commercial doctrine or a tax doctrine. See, in this 1 year, we had some problem in Jammu and Kashmir elections, some problem in Delhi elections, and see the philosophy, it's diluting. So one more loss of a good election, it will have an impact, it will have an economic impact. This is my understanding of little bit of commerce and economics with this political background. Same issue is there with the black money also. It's not simply that you can put on legislation and then bring, it's not possible. It has so much, it's a dinosaur. and a 16-legged dinosaur, not 4-legged. It has several angles to it, and you can't align everything at the same time before you can bring a law and legislation to bring the money back. Very complex structure. So, whether you want it or not, if it comes, it will come. But when it will come, how it will come, it's no longer in the realm of economics or commerce. It is always a political issue, and how the political will of the governance will decide the fate of GST in the country is my take. Thank you so much. Pleasure talking to all of you.